So, good morning. I'm delighted to be here. You're a very early bird. Yeah, I mean, 6:30 running, and then I was supposed to speak only 9:15. You're really early. Very good. So let me welcome all of you in Berlin to the Kirchentag, our key event, and then Wittenberg, and you're all coming. I saw that in your schedule. You can spend the night and then have this great worship service next Sunday. And I just saw the weather forecast. We'll have fine weather, and that's very, very important for the whole activities we're having. If it would be pouring rain next weekend, things would be a little bit different. So when you came to Berlin, the weather changed, and it's all nice now. It's a great chance that the Global Ecumenical Theological Institute is using the event of the commemoration of 500 years of Reformation in Germany in order to hold this conference. And I think reforming theology, transforming society, has been an effect of Reformation all over Europe. And in the consequence, we had a migrating church in Europe and towards the United States as people had to leave their homes because of confession. I saw in your program that you have a lot of opportunities to discuss that. First of all, I want to introduce a little bit of what we did and then give you a few insights where we discuss theologically. I'm not at 9:30, I'm through, okay? I promise. First of all, on October 31st, we had a great event here in Berlin, church service, televised, and then the president of the state had a reception, and he spoke about grace, which I found very interesting for the head of the state. Then we sent a truck all over Europe, 69 cities in Europe. They visited all over the winter. I was there in Prague and in Turku, in Finland. So this truck arrived in Wittenberg last Saturday on time. 11 o'clock, we could receive the truck, and we have gates from 69 cities now. In Wittenberg, you will see that when you come from the train station. So this is a sign of the international European dimension of the celebration. And then we opened on Saturday in a church service, open air, with 5,000 people on the marketplace in Wittenberg, the World Exhibition of Reformation. And which will last 16 weeks, and 16 weeks we will discuss in Wittenberg what does Reformation mean today with regard to Europe, globalization, justice, peace, spirituality, ecumenism, and so on. Parallel to that, we have a youth camp in Wittenberg, 2,000 young people, confirmation classes will be there. Some say it's going to be a kind of Woodstock of Reformation. I'm not so sure whether that's a good term for it. But it will be a generation of thousands of people. All in all, it will be 40,000 young people who have spent 3 days in Wittenberg during the summer, and 240 volunteers, 40 of them from abroad, who spent a whole year in Wittenberg helping us to carry through the whole Reformation World Exhibition. Then Wednesday, you will see that the Kirchentag starts here in Berlin. I'm looking forward to that very much. And then on Thursday, the Kirchentag starts in towns around Wittenberg, Leipzig, Magdeburg, Erfurt, Dessau, Jena, and Halle and Weimar. I always forget Weimar. So in these smaller towns, we will have smaller Kirchentag, and all people, we hope, come on Saturday and then Sunday to the great celebration. On October 31st, we will have a public holiday in Germany. This was not so easy to get because we have 16 federal states in this country and each state had to decide, but it will be a public holiday. And I hope that then the congregations really put something in place to show what Reformation means to them. A few glimpses in what we are talking about. One is, this time we can look critically at our own history. If you have time, you can read a little bit about the reception of Luther. 1817, he became the great German hero. You know, our nation started to be a nation, the nation needed a hero, and then you have all these podests where Luther is standing up here with the Bible in his hand. He's a national Luther then. 1917, nobody wanted to celebrate with us because World War I was going on, so the Germans had their Luther, consoler of the Germans in a terrible war, which they would lose in the end. The only Reformation Jubilee I have ever seen was Luther's 500th birthday, 1983. And there we were fighting whether he was East German or West German. Because up to then, Martin Luther in East Germany had been the servant of the princes. And suddenly he became a pre-revolutionary figure. which for West Germans was very astonishing. Suddenly Luther was a revolutionary in the East. Up to then he had not been. That shows that we have to be very critical of how we celebrate 2017. And the two key points that will be different from all other Reformation Jubilees this time is we will celebrate international. There are no national boundaries to our church. Every church is just a province of the world church, and we will have an ecumenical dimension. That's the next point. It's the first anniversary after a long experience of ecumenism. Not always easy, as you said. I mean, I've been 20 years in the World Council of Churches Central Committee, so ecumenism is not only fun, but we can also say that we will not celebrate against another confession, but this time it really has an ecumenical dimension, meaning that the Roman Catholics are part of it. It took a long time to find out how and what's possible and not, but after 1999 and the signing of the common understanding of justification by faith alone, I think we have a chance to celebrate ecumenically. And we will celebrate ecumenically because people from all over the world are celebrating with us, but also Baptists, Mennonites, Methodists, Anglicans, even Orthodox will be part of our celebration in Wittenberg. When you have time to look around, we have an ecumenical tent. And we were talking a long time, what is this tent of ecumenism? Do we show videos of how different we are and all the differences? And in the end, we said no. We will just show what we have in common. So we have the Bible there in many, 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 many languages. And we didn't put anything on. So if somebody takes a Bible, we say, if somebody steals a Bible, actually that's a good purpose. So we will have enough Bibles to bring all the time. Then we have one cross. We have a cross, we have a bell, and we have an icon. So this is all to show this is what we have in common, the Bible, the prayer, the call to worship, and so we have this tent of ecumenism. Ecumenism is not the only point. The third point is the dialogue of religions. It is the first time that the Germans have really looked at Luther's anti-Judaism. And this has hurt many people. You know, Luther, the great hero, and suddenly you talk about his anti-Judaism. It was a long debate. Some people said, stop it and don't make Luther such a difficult person. But in the end, our synod in 2015 distanced itself from Luther's writing on the Jews. That was a very important step. And 2016 even said, there is no mission among Jews from our side. And that was a very difficult endeavor you can imagine. The second point certainly is how do we get into dialogue with Muslims? We have had Muslims in our country for a long time, but we are not really in theological dialogue. This is just at the beginning. We are starting that. If you have time, Wittenberg is very small. You can walk around easily. We have reproduced a House of One. That's a project in Berlin. We are collecting money. We already have the architecture, but not the money. So in the middle, there's a meeting place. And from that meeting place, you can go to a church, to a synagogue, or to a mosque. And we want to build this thing in Wittenberg. So we have built it en miniature, so to say, in Wittenberg, just with a little bit of wood to show we need places of dialogue. And this is Reformation today. Our fourth point quickly is, how do we find religious language in a secular society? You know, when you come to Wittenberg, only 15% of the people living there are member of a church. In Eisleben, where Luther was born, it's even 7%. When I told that in Guatemala, then some people said, and what do the others believe in? Nothing. They say, I have no religion for myself. So I think that's Luther's power was to have a great language. And we have to search for religious language in a secular age. My fifth point, Reformation and women. Many people say Luther, well, he was not really a feminist, you cannot say that. But when he said that every baptized person is priest, bishop, pope, he gave way to, it took 450 years, but that's church history, it's not that long, we realized women are baptized too. So if women are baptized too, they can be priest, bishop, pope. And now for churches of the Reformation, that's a sign in the world that indeed women can be priest, bishop. When I was elected bishop, actually, I don't have the time for many stories, but the interesting thing was They didn't talk about my theology at all, but the press was talking about she has four daughters. Can a bishop have four daughters? The counter candidate had five sons, but nobody asked because everybody expects that there will be a woman who takes care of the rest. So that was a big debate. It was not about theology, it was about a non-theological factor, so to say. Overcoming divisions. It's the first celebration after the Leuenberg Agreement in Europe, and we have agreements like that in many places. So united, reformed, and Lutherans all over Europe accept each other as church, so they accept each other's ministry, and they can celebrate Eucharist together. I'm very, very happy that the Swiss have a pavilion of their own in Wittenberg. We opened that on Saturday too. It's a great pavilion, and you can see them all, Zwingli, Calvin, they're all there in even the Baptist movement. And they are part of the whole Reformation celebration, and that's very important, I think. When they split in 1529, it had not really been necessary, I'm sure, so we are celebrating together the Reformed, the United, and the Lutheran churches. That's very important, and also, as I said, the Mennonites, because the Lutheran World Federation in 2010 declared their guilt over against the Baptist, as they said, Anabaptist movement, and the Mennonites declared forgiveness. So that's a very important point, I think. We will talk about education. There's a great project, 500 schools. I don't know whether you've seen that. So Protestant schools all over the world connect in the internet, and they're now bringing that to Protestant universities. And there's a pavilion in Wittenberg where kids from all these schools will meet. Some will be there in person, some will be there virtual, because they will link via the internet. Important because education in our world is so decisive. Luther wanted every girl in that time, revolutionary, and boy to be able to read and write so that they can have their own conviction in faith. I think that's very important in a time of fundamentalism. You can ask questions. That's what the reformers wanted. Read the Bible for yourself, ask questions, and we can today even read it historically critically, and I think that's very important. Freedom, the theme of Reformation. For a long time, Lutherans read that in such a way that they would say, obey the state, and that's the best you can do, according to Paul. We have learned in German history, especially in Nazi times, that sometimes freedom has to be defended by resistance over against the state. And that's a lecture we also learned in the GDR. When the churches opened their doors for the dissidents, for those criticizing the state, the church was true to its message and contributed to the peaceful revolution of 1989. Justification of faith, my ninth point is, how do we talk about that today? But I'm convinced that in a so very much achievement and success-orientated society as ours, justification by faith alone has a very new meaning, and we have to spell it out. And finally, globalization. We will celebrate, as I said, in a global perspective, and in an age of rising nationalism, especially in Europe, but also in the United States, America first, make America great again, we can say Christianity is a global movement. We don't have national borders, and we will stand up over against nationalism. For me, it's a signal that we can give to a world torn apart in war, injustice, and destruction. We are one in Christ, and to show that can be a challenge and a contribution to our world today, and I hope we will have a signal from Wittenberg showing that to the world. We are an international community with brothers and sisters in Christ. Those were a few pointers, the challenges to be met in a Reformation Jubilee. I'm off to Wittenberg now. I will go back to the train station because there we have a discussion on faith reform. Actually, you could come to that discussion and contribute right away, I thought. Because we have a movement of theologians who said we need reform in faith because our insights, for instance, in a critical theological reading of the Bible, have never reached the parishes. You know, Mary being a virgin still is a great problem for many believers, and we have not translated what we No, why are there two creation stories? And then people don't know. So education and faith reform is something we have to contribute to. So this will be a discussion in Wittenberg right now. I'm very happy, not only because the weather is great, because we opened the World Exhibition of Reformation, and that you're all coming next weekend is a great sign. I hope you have a very good time, an exciting Kirchentag, a great conference, theological conference, and I can only say see you in Wittenberg next Sunday, and thank you for listening.